Imagine, it's the 90s, you're sitting in your room under a blanket. Outside, there is a small storm brewing as the raindrops hit the pavement, and the only thing that illuminates your room is the screen of an old CRT TV. However, you ignore all that, as the only thing that matters to you at this moment is the new Castlevania game on the PS1. With glee in your eyes and not a worry in your heart, you explore Dracula's castle, unveiling its secrets and destroying anything that gets in your way. Though some of the challenges and enemies give you trouble, you still push forward. And as the first ray of sunshine reaches your room, you finally defeat the final boss. Your journey comes to an end, but you will remember it forever. Moving 20 odd years to the present, now probably everything is different. The carefree nature was replaced by worries, the all-night gaming sessions by going to bed early as you have to work in the morning, the glee with discontent. But as you turn on Bloodstained Ritual of the Night for the very first time, for just a moment, you become a kid again. And this is not surprising, as both games were created by the same man. But you also realize that this game became more than just killing monsters and exploring a castle. It also became about a very important topic, namely, how difficult it is to remain fashionable in our day and age. Like the first explorers who were brave enough to travel to a new continent, you wake up on a ship. Here you meet your traveling companion, and this is where your journey begins. But like the explorers, you're not sure what you'll find on the other side. Though, as the first jellyfish monster appears, two things become certain. You're not in Kansas anymore, and you will have to fight to survive. However, the killing here is not just because. It is all for fashion, and fashion requires sacrifices. You quickly realize this when you get your first shard after killing a monster, which gives you supernatural power, symbolizing your search for the newest fashion trends. More specifically, if you have the newest and coolest, you are the talk of the city and the game becomes a breeze, while if you're behind the curve, the game becomes much more challenging. This is a mirror image of a person that does or does not follow fashion or cares about his or her appearance. That is, if you do, your life is much easier as you have more confidence in yourself, as well as others become more accepting of you. On the other hand, if you do not follow fashion, your looks raise eyebrows and you have stink lines coming out of you, people become dismissive of you and your opinions, making your life that much more difficult. This truth is further reinforced with all the weapons and armor you find, craft, and buy throughout the game. However, this game is not just about the efficiency of murder as a tool for finding the newest clothes. It is also a story that reinforces the fashion requires sacrifice narrative. More specifically, before disembarking, you get a huge exposition dump, which explains that you are on a mission to save your friend who became corrupt. However, before you can save him, you have to find him.
You're here to kill me, aren't you? Then first prove you can find me.
This is just like with many high society parties. That is, you know that there is going to be a big ball soon, but to find it and to be accepted, you have to have connections. And to get them, you have to traverse a huge castle. But before that, you have to fight a large mythical lady on a ship. This battle is like battling for a particular piece of clothes in a shop. In that situation, you know that you saw that cool My Neighbor Totoro shirt first and the other person is delusional. Though you often easily convert the other person to your way of thinking with several well-placed punches. After disembarking, you meet several people that help you on your way by selling their wares, exchanging what they have for food and other items, and by giving you stuff in exchange for you slaying enemies.
Kill those murderers dead!
Unsurprisingly, the bloodthirsty lady is not the one who betrays you in the end. But I digress. After you're done making friends, you enter the castle for the very first time. And it is just like the castle in Castlevania Symphony of the Night. That is, the budget for it was insane, the architect was probably as well, and many areas require you to have a particular item or power to reach them. And to get them, you have to traverse the castle, defeating bosses and collecting their powers, just like the best Pokémon trainer you were born to be. Though, just like in any good Castlevania game, often you have no idea how to reach a particular ledge or crevice, leading you consulting a guide. And all of this symbolizes your journey to the ball. That is, often to get appropriate shoes or clothes, you have to go to extreme lengths. Maybe you have to spend some time with your friend for him or her to lend you a coat. Maybe you have to spend your time doing monotonous work to have the money to buy those shoes. Or maybe, just maybe, you have to get your hands a bit dirty to get the last piece of jewelry. But with enough dedication, anything can be achieved. Oh, and in the castle you also find the murderous barber that can change your appearance, but he is just a red herring and is not related to the main message. After finding everything you need and after a relatively short journey, you find your friend and easily defeat him, though sadly you are unable to save him. But something feels amiss. The journey was too short, the battle too easy, and for some reason you got a game over screen. You figure that probably you missed something, and as you already proven to be a filthy casual, you do another Google search and find that you still have almost half the game to go. This, yet again, is another perfect representation that shows what happens when you go to an event ill-prepared. That is, even when you already know where it is, and maybe you already believe you managed to find the perfect dress, if you do not go all out, the event will come and go and you will not leave a mark on it. Because of that, even when you think you are ready, you are probably not, and still need to go the extra mile. And the extra mile in this game is to find a sword that can defeat the evil that plagues your friend. But to get the sword, you still have a long journey ahead, though it does not differ much from what you already experienced. You continue to murder enemies and bosses alike for upgrades, as well as, probably, for your own amusement, as throughout the game you lose your empathy. You also explore many areas that became tropes of the genre, such as water, fire, and ice worlds. Though you are a bit confused and relieved as there is no sewer level, and you always have Google on standby to help you figure out where to go and how to get a particular item that you need to appease the old lady, who is the manifestation of gluttony. Maybe... No, can be. Anyway, after all that, you find the samurai who is keeping the sword warm for you and defeat him. After acknowledging your button mashing skills, he gives you the sword, which will defeat the demon corrupting your friend. With the last piece of the puzzle in hand, which symbolizes that wow factor that will make you stand out at the party, you once more visit your friend. Though, without paying close attention or googling, you can still fail, as the sword is not for killing your friend, but for destroying the demon hidden as a red moon in the level. After slashing it once, the demon reveals itself, but the game does not end. You still have to find the demon once more and kill it for good. And the saddest part is that your friend still dies. And all of this symbolizes that even when you have that wow factor, you still have to work during the party itself to be noticed. And even if you get noticed, that just opens you the door to the secret after party, where you have to work even harder. But as you're not a quitter, you oblige, find the moon once more, and enter the secret Honey I Shrunk the Kids world. And as the ride never ends, you also explore this area, as well as fight a boss who uses money as his weapon of choice. Here, the money bag symbolizes some rich guy you need to impress. Also here, you slowly start to wonder, is all the sacrifice worth it? Is the carnage and suffering you're causing to the inhabitants of this castle, as well as the search for the newest and coolest, worth it? You keep this in mind after you defeat the money bag and move to the final stage of the game, the Ice World. In this godforsaken place, you find the demon that was corrupting your friend and defeat her. But as the ride never ends, the game also does not end just yet. You still need to find and kill the puppet master behind the curtain. And, to your surprise, the friendly neighborhood nun that was robbing you blind by selling overpriced junk is the main antagonist of the game. betrayed and hurt, you fight and defeat her. But the ride never ends. After you defeat her, you also have to defeat a powerful demon that she summoned. And as you travel this far already, one more death, or three if you count the three heads of the demon, one of which is a cute little kitty, is not an issue for a murderer like you. As the game slowly comes to an end and the castle crumbles, you are left wondering what all of this really meant. And then it hits you. In reality, this game was not about fashion, but about friendship. Throughout the games, you pushed yourself to the limit and even past it to impress everyone around you, to find the best and the strongest, to nail your look. But in the end, you realize that the people that only care about your look are not really your friends, and the crumbling castle symbolizes the destruction of the ideas you had throughout the game. The sun rises, the game ends, and you come out of it as a better person. But if you end up taking only one idea from this video, then take this one. Don't set yourself on fire to keep others warm.